Good evening. So it is day 4 of my coding adventure. We have done, when I say we, I have done about 4 chapters today, and I have learned a few things. So we'll start off with collections. So collection is grouping multiple items together, storing them with a single name called a variable. So what that means, this is my variable and here's my items. Now this is an example of a list in Python. So to create a list, we name a variable. We have to open these square brackets like so, and in here we specify, for example, our list of cities with in single quotes and a comma. And a good practice is to keep that comma at the end of your list as well, in case you will be adding some more down the line and you missed that one out. Okay, next we learned about the dictionary data type, which lets you store related information. And I had some trouble understanding this chapter. I'm not sure why. Maybe I was just tired yesterday, and I have redone that chapter today and it makes more sense, but maybe I just didn't get what the instructor was saying. But regardless, when it comes to dictionaries, again, we have to specify our variable name. So in this example here, they are referring to the California state symbols, I think. I just call them Kali symbols, and this is a curly bracket, and inside the curly bracket we have our name, a defining name, and the actual name that we want. So I'll show you that in a little bit. And next we are printing this information. So for example, I have my dictionary and I can print any of these by opening square brackets and providing the nickname or a name in the single quotes, and that would print my flower, which is California poppy. So it will not print flower, it will print California poppy. And so a few things in there. Oh, another thing, I found out how to comment out like large pieces of text. So for example, we have some text here, some here, some here, some here, some here. Okay, and if we were to do this by comment down, comment down, comment, comment down, it would take a while. But we can highlight all this stuff. We can then press Control and forward slash on your keyboard to comment all these other ones. And the same to comment them out. So that's very useful. That's something I'll definitely be using a lot in in my documentations for this, probably. But anyhow, let's move on to the example. Let's print some stuff out. So we get this. As you can see, got my California poppy. And when it comes to printing out lists, I actually didn't put this down, but we can do print. I think it was cities. And here I specify, for example, Buenos Aires. So we would do 0, 1, 0, 1, so be 3, and that should print out my Buenos Aires. Or maybe not. Was it in square brackets? May have been in square brackets actually. And I that sometimes is misleading. Yes. So it was Buenos Aires. So it's actually a square bracket. The reason why it is 3 is because when we, when we note down the index numbering, it actually starts at 0. So this would be 0, 1, 2, 3, which is why I have put 3 to get my Buenos Aires. But if we put 2, we would get Mumbai, as you can see. Quite useful actually. And I recall reading a book about arrays and how to store it. It was actually a book on C or C sharp. I think it was learning C. And I've read this book, and this is one of the things I managed to remember, but I'm not like expert in C or anything. I forgot how to, even write hello and that thing. But I did manage to remember that piece of information, which means learning something from that did not go to waste. Anyhow, we then learned about iterations. So when we were learning about iterations, let me just comment this out. Iteration basically means repeating the same procedure multiple times until it reaches a specific point. So like for example, you have 5 shirts that you got out of your wash and you need to fold them. You would fold them 5 times and then that's it. So if a script needs to do something 5 times, it will do it 5 times using the iteration, and then it will stop once it reaches the end. So let me uncomment this one. So in here I have my list of my spices. Salt isn't a spice, but the instructor said because he's the cook, so salt is a spice, so we will go with that. And this is something new. This is the for loop. So this is for loop, that's what it's called. And we use this to run this thing multiple times if we need to. So for example, if I were to print spice on its own, I don't have such a thing. So we have our variable called spices, and for so this means that spice in there can be anything. So for basically what that means, for each spice in spices, which is in this list, print each of these. So if I'm going to run this thing, I'll get my salt, pepper, cumin, turmeric. So I could effectively replace that word with relax, and that I will still get the same thing. Or maybe, because yes, so I didn't change it here. Okay, but if I were to run this thing, I would get the same result. Let me just show you on a clean screen. So whatever you put in here, it doesn't matter. But what you put in here, this stuff matters, and in what you're going to print. So let me just put this back to spice because it's, it's more relatable. Spice. And like so. And then we've done a little exercise where we were counting using this iteration, to like 100. And this is a while loop, so we want to keep doing something until it reaches a certain point. So similar to loop, but not exactly. So the conditions between for loop and while slightly differ in a way. What I mean by that is while I is equal to or less than 100, this condition will keep on going, but it would not do like for each like 100 do something or something. So they're slightly different. And here the read I is actually my I is my variable in here. So I equals to 5, and then while 5 equals to 100 or is lesser, we would need to print that, and this sign is to increment by 5, so it will count by 5 each time. So 5, 10, 15, 20, all the way to 100, and then it stops running, as you can see. That was quite interesting. I didn't know the plus and an equal sign is used to increment. But it kind of makes sense now that I look at it, because I equals 5, but before we put plus in there, so we incremented. So let me try something here, because what if we were to change it to 50? What if I wanted to go the other way? Can I do minus equals? Is that going to work? Well, 50 or lesser. What will that do? Oh shoot, how do I stop this? Yeah, as you can see, it actually, yeah. I need to stop this thing. Kill terminal. So it has done it the other way. But, oh, actually, it destroyed my, oh shit. Sorry. it broke my Visual Studio. No. Oh, it's probably still going, right? Where are you? Reopen. Alright. How do I kill terminal? But I did that, no? Yeah, I killed my... I totally killed my Visual Studio. Alright. But we got it back. Let me just save this thing. Probably want to save this as well. And this. And this. Okay. Where was I? Iteration, yeah. So that was very interesting. But yeah, we have to be careful how we play with this. Oh, yes. And then we had the iteration challenge. So we had to print the name of all the fruits in the terminal, print each name on a separate line. Yeah, so this one was interesting. Yes, let me just show you real quick. So in here, I called it a basket, and inside my basket I had all my fruits, okay? Now the challenge was to print the name of all the fruits in the basket, in the terminal, print each name on a separate line, above the list, print our fruit selection. Now, so I got this challenge right, and I'll show you how it what it looks like the correct way. Okay, so we have all our fruits and our fruit selection statement, sentence actually. Now, if I were to put this inside my for loop, I would get our fruit selection after each of these fruits. So I would get 1, 2, 3, 4. How many do we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I would get 6 of these, which I don't want. So this needs to be at the top. Okay, that's quite interesting. Alright, next, so we also learn how to import Python modules. So we defined a function, we have then imported that to our next script, which is this one here. So in here we are doing multiplication, 10 times 5 I believe. And this keyword, it imports our test module. Importing module. Get rid of this. So this is the name of my module. I call it testmodule.py, and I am importing this information there. I'm importing this module. So if I were to run this, I would get 10 times 5 equals 50. So the reason for that is for default printf. Yeah, I think that's the multiplication sign right there. And then this, they didn't explain about this much, so I don't know how it fully functions. What was f for again? I don't remember. But yes, so we have done importing our functions and modules, I meant. Modules can help you write code as well, actually, so that they're available online and help you write code quicker. Like if there's like a common problem and that is being encountered a lot, some people they wrote a solution for that type of problem and posted online for people to import modules and import it into their workflow and into their code and use that to solve the problems and continuing with their own custom code. All right, and this is working with strings, so this is where things get tricky. So we have our value, which is input into number printf plus. So this is concatenation, when multiple strings are combined into a single string. So this is what is happening here. So we print the value, which is input, plus we're adding another comment in there. And then we print, when you multiply by 10, this is the result you get. So we have another variable, and this here is an integer, which is a whole number, and we are referencing this value to our variable here. So when we input the number, it will print in the integer times 10. So whatever we do, we get a times 10. So we're gonna enter number 50 and we get 500 and all those things. So that's that. I'm just comment this out. This was an interesting one right there. So finding patterns in strings. There's a lot of stuff here. So in this exercise, we had a first name variable, last name, note, and then we were capitalizing all this information. Okay. So let me just run this thing. So as you can see, we have a lowercase for the first name, a lowercase for the last name. But because we capitalize this thing, we get the capitalized result. And then we were searching through the strings here using the dot find and then award. And I think for 7-blank, and then it would find the location, and not quite, was it 0 and 1? It was something like this. Where was it? 8 maybe. So we define, we tell it where to search. I don't remember how to do it. Maybe it was 1 and blank. Nope, 1 and 7. I forgot how to search for this thing. Yeah, that's something I'll have to remind myself of. It's quite useful. to be able to search through certain pieces of text. But it did have 7 in there, I just don't remember what kind of format. Maybe there was a space. No, that can't be right. Yeah. So, but the way we define is beginning, which is dot find the first occurrence award, and then the first occurrence and the last. Oh, I see. It's not gonna find 7 because 7 is commented out. Oh, I think yes. So it's searching line by line. So where's our noble price 23? Will that work? Not quite, but let's try 28 onward. Still no. 21. I believe I am close, so I'm gonna just put this back here. I must be close because when we search for this array, how about 29? Let's start from 30. Oh, no way. Yes, that is to be expected. 22. Okay, how about 22 here? Still no. 29. Okay, you got me there. So my note dot find is at line 23, which, but I am starting my search from line 22. What if I were to put 23 and nothing, which I think I already did and nothing happened, right? Yes, I thought so. Ah. Okay. Let's have a look at the output once more. Expressions. So find first occurrence of award, which is this. Or maybe. Syntax error, okay. Definitely not like this. It needs to be like this. Maybe 1 and 0. Yes, 70, yes. How about 0 through 70? Negative 1, I think, usually means false. About 70 and 0. So all the way, search entire thing. That's not true. That's gonna bug me now. Find first occurrence. Finding text, yes. So this is called slicing, which is getting part of a string value, but award underscore location dot note dot find award, yes. What if I had to get rid of all this thing? I get 0. I don't remember finding patterns in strings. Let me take a quick look at finding patterns in strings. So let's have a look. Yes. What does the code look like? First and last name, yes, yes, yes. There is a number in there, I know that for sure. Seven and a warped dash text, okay. Print a word text. But this ain't gonna work because seven goes all the way up there. Let me just clean this thing. Yes, as expected. We are on line 23. That should work. Maybe. Where's mine? Oh, it's right there. I see it. Wait, let me just rerun this thing. I got it right, and then I've done something. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Oh, I get it. Okay, so it starts the search from this line. Now, if I pick 7, it goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 all the way to that line to find it. And then, if I were to indent from here, it would search 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 downward. Okay, so. Left side is upwards, right side is downwards. Okay. Cool, got it. That was nice. And I finally understood that I was just missing some parts. Okay. Dot note. Old location. Okay. So we can comment this out. I don't think I still fully get it, but it will do for now. Next we have, yes, regular expressions. So this thing, when we were searching for like a specific digit or a thing, so it was actually this piece of code right there. So we imported regular expression support to include the special characters and all those things, and yeah, so we have description, which is nice. Escape backslash all none of the registry. Yeah, I don't know what all of this is. Okay, and then we have our variables, and then we use this to search through our variables here in this format. Okay, so I'm just gonna do that. So the objective was to use this variable, and R ignores the backslash, and D is for digit. So we have specified to search for 5 digits, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of a zip code, which is minimum in the US, and then 9 digits and more, and then phone number, and yeah. So let's see what this does. So we have a match for the first 5 digits because we have 5 digits. We have a match for the second variable because we have 5 digits here. But the phone number we have none because it's not 5 digits straight. So it stops after 3, we have a dash, and then continues. So that's why there is no match. Okay. So I'm just gonna comment this back out. Ooh, actually just this part there. Here. The real challenge begins here. So we have, so based on what I have learned so far, I need to create something, like a converter in a way. So I need to convert miles into kilometers, but there was a catch. Let's see, what was printed to the terminal, and then text description float for that, so we can use float. So remember, in the foundations course, the very first one, float gives you, allows you to type in a number that has like a decimal, so 22.24 whatever, and it can go on. So basically you can store a very large number in a float. Okay, so we need to enter a distance in miles. Okay, so let's call our variable miles, which is equals to the input, and go away. Now we need enter a distance in miles. So that's where we start. So we then need to take this value, print it to the terminal. Okay. So let's see how this will look. So let's say I have 5 miles. Cool. Alright. So that works. Now So I need another variable in here, which actually he pointed it here. So he gave me like a big tip here. So let's say I want to use the word convert. Convert. Actually, let's, yeah. Okay, it's equals miles. .609344. Of course the catch is, okay, this needs to be a float, so I think float, that's how you specify. Wouldn't I need to put this in brackets like so? I still don't quite understand the use of brackets here, but we'll figure this out as we go. So let's say where's my terminal? I'll just run this. Yeah, that's fine. I don't care about this. I just needed to bring up the terminal. So let's say 5 times 1.609344. I just needed to grab this value. And why did I need to bring this value? because I'll be using this to test the accuracy of my script. Okay, so I don't need this anymore. Okay. Can I assign function to call? Wait, what? To function call. Syntax. Ugh. Or is it just float like that? Okay, oops. How do I define a type? That's what I need to find out. I need to find out how to define a type, which I don't think I did yet. Maybe I did, I just forgot. It was probably somewhere in the beginning. Yeah. Okay, let's get rid of this. Okay, as it goes. That's fine. I just run this thing. Okay. So now. So now we would need to print. To the terminal text description. I don't think that will work, but that's my catch. I need to define it's a float, otherwise it will not input. Yes, this is a float, and this is also a float. I did define an integer before. Input. Float, like so. Float. Let's see if that works. Invalid syntax. Why? Oops, accidentally hit the microphone. No, I back to beginnings. Where are you? Good question. Where is my code? Oh yes. Creating functions. Yeah, I think that's the one. Oh, that entire thing. No, but that's car wash, that's not the one. Guessing game, hello world, history, which one in chapter? Beyond fundamentals, challenge, nope. Could have been there. No. Where was I defining those things? I forgot. I really don't want to give up just yet. Wait, actually, I just had another look at the syntax. Maybe it's... float. Miles. Equals input. Could it be so? Assign to function call. Convert a string or number to a float if possible. Can assign to call. No, it's not that. This maybe still doesn't like it, but I know my Visual Studio has been funny, but I think this is it, because when I take a look at that float miles equals input, I think that took it and then came as equals. I think we need to do it again. Float miles. Times. Games equals. Float times. No, but I need to. But maybe. Let's see. Print. Miles. Times. It is an undefined variable. Oh, wait. Could it be? I don't think that is. let's have a look. Let's say 5. So this is correct because we were able to get here, but once we put in the value, it does not work. So print miles. I'm getting closer. That's a good challenge. That's a good challenge, makes you think. Again, let's go back to basics. So let's try and do what it's in the so km value equals to miles times 1.609344, and then print km. That work? Nope. Take no keyword argument. Type error flopped. No idea. Let's look at the solution.
You had fun with that challenge. I enjoy programming puzzles that involve working with strings, but there are a number of moving parts here, so if you felt overwhelmed, don't worry. As you get more familiar with string manipulation and methods, you'll become more comfortable with doing this kind of coding. For now, let me show you how I solved this. This value that I have up here for conversion, 1.6 and some change. So I'm just going to copy and paste that in. And then I'm going to print a label for my data. So I'm going to print that value in kilometers is, and then finally, I want to print the number that I calculated to the terminal. So print kilometers. I'll save those changes. I will execute my code. At that prompt, I'll type 50. And the response I get is my label, that value in kilometers is.
Okay, I messed up somewhere. Oh yes. That should be okay now. Got quite wrong. Oh wow. That's still, that is very useful to know. So at least I learned how to convert. So one thing I learned is that Python always uses strings. So in order to convert that to need to use a variable. That's something I did not know. That's very interesting. Okay, anyway, this will be it for today. and I'll see you tomorrow. Have a good evening.